I have to give you a fancy introduction. Good afternoon. President Biden is continuing to follow through on his key promise to take swift and bold action that addresses the climate crisis, building on his day one actions of rejoining the Paris Agreement and strengthening our clean air and water protections and holding polluters accountable. Today, he will take executive action to tackle the climate crisis at home and abroad while creating good-paying union jobs, building sustainable infrastructure, and delivering environmental justice. I'm thrilled today, as a part of our effort to bring policy experts into the briefing room, we're joined by two very special guests who are going to talk to you all about today's executive orders and take a few questions as well. And I will always, as always, play the role of bad cop when they have to go. National Climate Advisor Gina McCarthy and Special Presidential Envoy for Climate and my former boss, former Secretary of State John Kerry. And a big day for Boston in the briefing room. So, okay, with that, go ahead.
Thank you. It's a big day for Boston every day. Thank you, everybody. Today, President Biden will build on the actions he took on day one, and he'll take more steps to fulfill commitments he made to tackle the climate crisis while creating good-paying union jobs and achieving environmental justice. In his campaign, he and Vice President Harris put forward the most ambitious climate vision that any presidential ticket had ever embraced. And he spent more time campaigning on climate than we have ever seen. The president also has consistently identified the climate crisis as one of four interrelated existential crises that are gripping our nation all at once. And he's demanding answers that can address all four. And he's not waiting to take action, getting us started on his first day in office, because science is telling us that we don't have a moment to lose to fight against all four of these crises in a way that recognizes their intersectionality. He's already committed the U.S. to re-enter the Paris Climate Agreement, and he committed us as well to start undoing the assault on our environment that has occurred over the past 4 years, and he is now taking additional action to really target the challenge of climate change. So today for me is a very good day. Just 1 week into his administration, President Biden is continuing to move us forward at the breadth and the pace that climate science demands. Today's executive order starts by saying it is the policy of this administration that climate considerations shall be an essential element of U.S. foreign policy and national security. That's where the big guy comes in. It gives my colleague, John Kerry, the first ever international climate envoy, the authority to really drive forward a process that will restore American leadership on climate throughout the world. And you will see and hear more about that from Secretary Kerry. But here at home, we have to do our part, or we will not be able to make the kind of worldwide change that climate change demands. So this executive order establishes a White House Office of Domestic Climate Policy, and it directs everyone who works for the president to use every tool available at our disposal to solve the climate crisis, because we're going to take a whole-of-government approach. We're going to power our economy with clean energy. We're going to do that in a way that will produce millions of American jobs that are going to be good-paying, that are going to be jobs that have the opportunity for workers to join a union. Because, as President Biden has often told us, when he thinks of climate change, his first thought is about jobs. And it should be, because people in this country need a job. And this is about making that happen in the most creative and significant way that the federal government can move forward. And we're going to make sure that nobody is left behind. And I'm not just talking about communities in terms of environmental justice, but workers as well. This order takes historic strides to address environmental injustice. It creates both a White House interagency task force to address environmental justice, as well as an advisory council. It directs the Department of Health and Human Services to create an Office of Climate Change and Health Equity, because after all, climate change is the most significant public health challenge of our time. And it tasks the Department of Justice with establishing an Office of Climate Justice, because we know the communities who are being hurt, and we know we have to start enforcing the standards today and ensuring that they are part of the solution in the places that we can invest. In fact, it commits 40% of our investment in clean energy towards disadvantaged communities so they can benefit from the new jobs that are available and seed that better future. President Biden's order establishes a working group on coal and power plant communities, because we have to make sure that in this transition, every agency in government is using every tool at their disposal to drive resources to those communities. And it fulfills long-standing commitments to leverage our vast natural resources to contribute to our clean energy future. It places a pause and review on new oil and gas leases on federal public lands and waters, consistent with a promise President Biden has repeatedly made and has been very clear in the face of efforts to distort his promise. And it sets a goal of doubling offshore wind production by 2030. In addition, he plans to sign a presidential memorandum that aims to restore scientific integrity across the federal government and earn back the public's trust, making a commitment to base solutions on the best available science and data. So today is a very big day for science and for our efforts to power our economy with good-paying union jobs. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's great to be here. Let me say, first of all, what a pleasure it is to be here with Gina. I'm a big fan of Gina's. Gina and I worked very, very closely together during the campaign when we sat down to bring the Bernie Sanders folks together around the Biden climate plan. And she is the perfect person to be tackling the domestic side of this equation, which is complicated. And nobody knows the details better than she does. And nobody's going to be more effective at corralling everybody to move in the same direction. It's also an enormous pleasure for me to be here with Jen Psaki. She mentioned that nobody was her boss, but I had the privilege of working with her. And she, 7 years ago, we gathered in the State Department briefing room. She's traded up, obviously, but she has not given away any of her fundamental principles and commitment to telling you all the truth, telling the American people the truth, and doing so with great candor and transparency, and I'm very happy to be here with her. The stakes on climate change just simply couldn't be any higher than they are right now. It is existential. We use that word too easily, and we throw it away. But we have a big agenda in front of us on a global basis, and President Biden is deeply committed, totally seized by this issue, as you can tell by this executive order and by the other, the initiative of getting back into Paris immediately. That's why he rejoined the Paris Agreement so quickly, because he knows it is urgent. He also knows that Paris alone is not enough, not when almost 90% of all of the planet's emissions, global emissions, come from outside of U.S. borders. We could go to zero tomorrow, and the problem isn't solved. So that's why today, 1 week into the job, President Biden will sign this additional executive set of orders to help move us down the road, ensuring that ambitious climate action is global in scope and scale, as well as national here at home. Today, in the order that he will sign, that Gina has described to you, he makes climate central to foreign policy planning, to diplomacy, and to national security preparedness. It creates new platforms to coordinate climate action across the federal agencies and departments, sorely needed. And most importantly, it commissions a national intelligence estimate on the security implications of climate change to give all of us an even deeper understanding of the challenge. This is the first time a president has ever done that. And our 17 intelligence agencies are going to come together and assess exactly what the danger and damage and potential risks are. The order directs the State Department to prepare a transmittal package seeking Senate advice and consent on the Kigali Amendment to the Montreal Protocol, an amendment that by itself, if ratified and fully enforced globally, could hold the Earth's temperature by 0.5 of an entire degree, not insignificant. And it sets forth a process for us to develop an ambitious new Paris target, as well as a U.S. climate finance plan, both of which are essential to our being able to bring countries of the world together to raise ambition and meet this moment when we go to Glasgow for the follow-on agreement to Paris. So that's the only way for the world to succeed together, my friends. And so, again, this is an issue where failure literally is not an option. As he committed to doing on the campaign trail, the president is announcing that he will host a leaders' summit on climate change less than 3 months from now, on April 22nd, Earth Day, which will include a leader-level reconvening of the major economies forum. We'll have specifics to lay out over time, but the convening of this summit is essential to ensuring that that 2021 is going to be the year that really makes up for the lost time of the last 4 years, and that the UN Climate Conference, COP26 as it's called, which the UK is hosting in November, to make sure that it is an unqualified success. The road to Glasgow will be marked not just by promises, but by progress at a pace that we can all be proud of, and Gina is going to be putting her efforts into making certain that that is true. The world will measure us by what we can do here at home. So with these executive actions today, we believe we're steps further down that journey. Thank you.
All right, let's start with Nancy.
Thank you so much, Secretary Kerry. A question for you and then for Administrator McCarthy. You talked about the fact that it won't really matter what we do very much if the rest of the world doesn't do the same thing, but the U.S. has had a fairly rocky relationship with China recently. How do you plan to try to bring both China and India to the table on this issue?
Well, before I answer that, let me just say that the issue of making a difference, i.e. what we do at home, what I'm saying is you can't solve the problem alone, but our doing things makes an enormous difference. What Gina succeeds in pulling together is essential to our ability to have credibility in the world. Now, with respect to China, obviously we have serious differences with China on some very, very important issues. And I am as mindful of that as anybody, having served as Secretary of State and in the Senate. The issues of theft of intellectual property and access to market, South China Sea, I mean, run the list. We all know them. Those issues will never be traded for anything that has to do with climate. That's not going to happen. But climate is a critical standalone issue that we have to deal on in the sense that China is 30% of the emissions of the world. We're about 15% of the emissions of the world. You add the EU to that, and you've got three entities that are more than 55% or so. So it's urgent that we find a way to compartmentalize, to move forward, and we'll wait and see. But President Biden is very, very clear about the need to address the other issues with China. And I know some people have been concerned. Nothing is going to be siphoned off into one area from another.
And then a question for either of you on coal. Your executive order talks about oil and gas on federal lands, but it doesn't really say much about coal. What is this administration's policy when it comes to coal?
Well, in terms of the oil and gas decision, it was to make sure that we take a little pause and review the entire strategy of how we're looking at public lands. So it will include looking at what new leases ought to be approved and sold. It's looking at our ability also to look at coal in that mix. So the program review is going to look at how we manage public lands consistent with climate, but also consistent with the marriage between climate and really growing jobs of the future. So it will be in the mix to be looked at, but it is not at this point included. It was not part of the commitments on the campaign, but we're going to take a close look at all of it. And can I just add on your comment about China? Which I'm not going to speak to the international dynamic, but I am going to say that part of the challenge that we face here is a challenge that President Biden has already started to address with his Buy America pledge. We have to start not just shifting to clean energy, but it has to be manufactured in the United States of America, you know, not in other countries. And there is going to be a large discussion about how we make sure that a lot of the investment is about building up our manufacturing base again. That's great jobs. That's often, hopefully, union jobs. But it is also a wonderful opportunity for us to recoup the benefits of that manufacturing and lower the cost of clean energy. Part of the way we're going to get there is by making sure the federal government buys American and that the federal government looks at its procurement across every agency so that the breadth of what we spend is spent designed to advance job growth in the United States, to advance health benefits for environmental justice communities, and to begin to tackle the very challenge, the existential challenge of climate change.
Jeff Mason.
Thank you. Jeff Mason with Reuters. Question for both of you. Can you give us a sense of when you expect to have the so-called NDC, or U.S. target for cutting greenhouse gas emissions as part of the Paris Accord? And can you also give us a sense of how ambitious you plan to make that number? Will it be 40%, 50%, higher than that?
Well, we're united in this. So.
Yeah, I'm the dude who's supposed to deliver this in a timely way, and he sets the timing. So that basically, we want to make sure that the NDC is something that can be announced before the summit on Earth Day. And so we're going to be out of the gate working with the agencies to see what kind of reductions and mitigation opportunities there are. And also, again, to look at our public lands to make sure that we can continue to store carbon in our soil, to work with agriculture and others, to look at how we better manage our forests so we're not seeing the devastating forest fires that we've been having before. So all across the federal government, every agency, and you'll see many of them specifically tasked in this executive order, will participate in the task force that we're going to have to actually develop the most aggressive NDC that we can to deliver the kind of boost that Secretary Kerry is looking for to be able to ensure that our international efforts are robust and sufficient to address the challenge internationally.
Just to follow up on that, perhaps for Secretary Kerry, how do you assure international partners that the U.S. will stick to whatever you propose after having seen the Trump administration take the U.S. out of the Paris Accord?
Well, that's precisely why we're going to stick by it, and I think our word is strong. I've been on the phone for the last few days talking to our allies in Europe, elsewhere, around the world, and they are welcoming us back. They know that this administration already had a significant part of what has brought us to, will bring us to Glasgow, which was the Paris Agreement. The Obama-Biden administration had great credibility on this issue, and having President Biden be the person now who is driving this forward is enormously meaningful to the folks there. And they also know that I was deeply involved in the negotiations in Paris, and am now asked by the President, by President Biden, to make certain that we do the same at Glasgow, if not more. So I have had no one question our credibility at this point in time. Someone probably will. And the answer will be that I think we can achieve things in the course of the next 4 years that will move the marketplace, the private sector, global finance, innovation and research, that in fact no political person in the future would be able to undo what the planet is going to be organizing over these next months and years. This is the start of something new. I don't know if you read Larry Fink's letter of BlackRock the other day, yesterday, but there's a new awareness among major asset managers and commercial banks and others about the need to be putting resources into this endeavor, because it is major in investment demand. So I think the proof will be in what we do. Neither Gina nor I are going to start, you know, throwing around a lot of big promises. But you heard what she just said, and we will work very closely, because we're going to try to bring to the table to help inform her and the folks she's working with what we're picking up abroad and what people are doing abroad and the steps that they're taking and how we now have to measure ourselves against them and they will measure themselves against us. We are well aware of that.
Can I just add something?
I just want to call attention to the fact that cities and states have really picked up the initiative to move forward on clean energy, because the solutions are cheap. The solutions compete effectively against fossil fuels. We are talking about solutions that we're not asking anybody to sacrifice, but are to their advantage. And if you look at the record over the past 4 years, while the prior administration might have wanted energy, clean energy to head in a different direction, it's gone faster and farther than anyone ever expected. And the idea that we could, with this new work that we're doing together, send signals to the marketplace through our purchasing at the federal level and are relooking at different ways of having on-the-ground change, we can build that demand. We can actually grow significantly millions of clean energy jobs. And all of a sudden, the question won't be whether the private sector is going to buy into it. The private sector is going to drive it. And so this is going to be a signal setter, the way the federal government ought to set on what our values are, what we think the future needs to be. And this is a value-laden effort that President Biden has undertaken with full knowledge that it's going to benefit jobs, it's going to benefit our health, and it's going to lead to that future we want to hand to our children.
We'll just do these two in the front, and then they will come back, I promise. So go ahead.
Thank you. Mr. Secretary, if you would, there certainly are oil and gas industry workers who are watching you both right now, who will hear the message that the takeaway to them is that they are seeing an end to their livelihoods. What do you say to them, particularly those people who President Trump struck a chord with on the campaign trail when he promised to save their jobs? What is your message to them right now? And also to the oil industry executives who are listening, are you putting them on notice today?
Well, we didn't come here to put anybody on notice except to the seriousness of President Biden's intent to do what needs to be done to deal with this crisis, and it is a crisis. With respect to those workers, no two people are more in this room are more concerned about it, and the President of the United States has expressed in every comment he has made about climate the need to grow the new jobs that pay better, that are cleaner. You look at the consequences of black lung for a miner, for instance, and measure that against the fastest growing job in the United States before COVID was solar power technician. The same people can do those jobs, but the choice of doing the solar power one now is a better choice. Similarly, you have the second fastest growing job pre-COVID was wind turbine technician. This is happening. 70% of all the electricity that's come online in the United States in the last few years came from renewables. Not, coal plants have been closing over the last 20 years. So what President Biden wants to do is make sure those folks have better choices, that they have alternatives, that they can be the people who go to work to make the solar panels. They were making them here at home. That is going to be a particular focus of the Build Back Better agenda. And I think that unfortunately workers have been fed a false narrative. No surprise, right, for the last few years. They've been fed. The notion that somehow dealing with climate is coming at their expense. No, it's not. What's happening to them is happening because of other market forces already taking place. And what the financiers, the big banks, the asset managers, private investors, venture capital are all discovering is there's a lot of money to be made in the creation of these new jobs in these sectors. So whether it's green hydrogen that is going to come, whether it is geothermal heat, or whatever it's going to be, those are jobs. The same worker who works in South Carolina today putting together a BMW, which happens to be made there, and is currently an internal combustion engine, can put together a car, but it's electric. So this is not a choice between having jobs, having good jobs, having the quality of life. Quality of life will be better when Gina has put her team together that produces choices for us that are healthier, less cancer, cleaner air. The greatest cost of America, the greatest cause of children being hospitalized every summer in the United States, we spend $55 billion a year on it, is environmentally induced asthma. That will change as we begin to rein in what we used to call pollution in this country, because it is pollution. And I think that workers are going to see that with the efforts of the Biden administration, they're going to have a much better set of choices. And frankly, it will create more jobs than stuck where we were.
Could I just add by pointing out a couple of things in the executive order that I want you to just call to your attention? We talked about the Civilian Conservation Corps. That is an opportunity to put younger people into work in vitally important efforts. But if you look at this, it also has set up a task force that is looking at these coal communities that are really reliant on their local energy and utility. And it talks about how do we revitalize those economies. And it talks about how we can put people to work using the skills they currently have where they are to start looking at those old abandoned oil and gas wells that are spewing out methane, or all of the coal that is mines that haven't been properly closed that are doing the same, that has great impact on climate, but also will keep an opportunity for those individual workers to have work in their own communities. We're not going to ask people to go from the middle of Ohio or Pennsylvania and ship out to the coast to have solar jobs. You know, solar jobs will be everywhere, but we need to put people to work in their own communities. That's where their home is. That's where their vision is. So we're creatively looking at those opportunities for investment so that we can get people understanding that we are not trying to take away jobs. Remember, when we say climate change, eventually people are going to think jobs, just like President Biden, when he hears the words climate change. And so we'll do everything we can to recognize that revitalization is necessary in these communities, to find creative ways to put them to work, and then we're going to do as Secretary Kerry says and start investing in new technologies and new manufacturing. And that includes large manufacturing like cement and steel. That's work that we should be doing here. That's work that inevitably is going to be necessary to rebuild our infrastructure, which is also one of the biggest opportunities we have for job growth moving forward.
Two quick questions. Sure. Administrator, one to you and one to the Secretary, if I may. What you may hear from some corners of criticism is why are we doing this now when we're already in an economic crisis? You look at the state of New Mexico, where one-third of the state's budget is funded by oil and gas. So why not let the country get back on its feet before we do this?
Well, the issue in New Mexico is that somebody reported a bit incorrectly, or maybe not as precisely enough, that this wasn't about impacting existing permits and fracking. This was about new leases on federal lands. So I think that the opportunity for the states to continue to accrue the royalties from
from both coal and oil and natural gas that is properly done on federal lands is going to continue, and there's even an opportunity in the review of that program to look at the royalty issues, look at the job growth opportunities, look at a variety of things to make sure that public lands are being properly managed. Now, in terms of the job issue, we're explicitly doing this because our economy is right now stagnant. We have millions of people out of work, out of jobs, millions of people that are afraid they can't feed their families. If you're faced with that, what do? You boost the economy and you grow jobs. But why at the same time aren't we thinking about the weaknesses of our current economy in terms of the number of environmental justice communities that have been left behind, the number of people that are breathing dirty air and their kids are getting asthma? So instead, let's think about all of it at the same time. I know it's a crazy idea in a bureaucracy. You're only supposed to do one thing. Well, we're going to do and think about all of it. Because people need to have jobs. This is all about building the jobs of the future we want, not continuing to niddle at an economy that is no longer going to be where our future lies.
Mr. Secretary, to you right now, over the course of this first week, there are a lot of big priorities here. There's COVID, the economy, immigration, racial justice, now climate change. As a veteran of Congress, of the Senate, what is the priority and how quickly do you need legislation to make this permanent?
Well, the priority is precisely what the president has set out, all of them, all six of the major crises that he faces. And he's addressing every single one of them, and he knows that the United States, all of us, have the ability to be able to do that. And the reason that has to be done is every single one of them are life and death. Every single one of them represent a challenge to the very fiber of our society. And the other reason, obviously, everything, I agree with everything Gina said, but I'd simply add that the other reason for doing it now is the science tells us we have to. And that's one of the things the president is restoring today in the executive order, is respect for science and the science office. So,
$2 trillion price tag, $2 trillion for COVID, $2 trillion for this. It's a lot of money to a lot of Americans.
It is real money, and yes, it's a lot of money, but you know what? It costs a lot more if you don't do the things we need to do. It costs a lot more. There are countless economic analyses now that show that it is now cheaper to deal with the crisis of climate than it is to ignore it. We spent $265 billion 2 years ago on three storms, Irma, Harvey, and Maria. Maria destroyed Puerto Rico. Harvey dropped more water on Houston in 5 days than goes over Niagara Falls in a year. And Irma had the first recorded winds at 185 miles an hour for 24 sustained hours. That last year, we had one storm, $55 billion. So we're spending the money, folks. We're just not doing it smart. We're not doing it in the way that would actually sustain us for the long term. So this is critical. The goal of the Paris Agreement was to hold the Earth's temperature increase to 2 degrees centigrade. Even if you did everything that was in Paris, we're going up to 3.7 or 4. That's catastrophic. What President Biden is trying to do is listen to science, listen to facts, and make tough decisions about what we need to do to take the world to a better place, and particularly our own country. And that is what he is committed to doing. So, yes, there are a lot of challenges right now, which sadly, all of them were exacerbated by the last 4 years. Now we have to try to make up for that. And that is a hard pull, but this president is capable of doing it, and he's putting together a great team that I think can help him do that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Gina McCarthy. Thank you, Secretary Kerry, for joining us.